Welcome, everyone. It's great to see such a large group. Welcome. Hope you grabbed your lunch and are ready for an exciting session. So I have the pleasure of introducing Vivian, which I will in a couple minutes. But first, I'd like to introduce our new MIT Leadership Center series, iLab. And last spring, we formed a committee of stakeholders from across the school to explore the kind of world-class speakers we wanted to invite to MIT. Our goal throughout the year is to bring a diverse set of speakers who exemplify MIT's brand of leadership, specifically people who make an impact through innovative, problem-focused leadership. They tackle wicked hard problems by creating a strong culture where others step up to innovate and lead at every level. We often talk about distributed leadership here at the school. The Innovative Leadership Series, iLead at MIT, celebrates innovators who make a difference in the world. They transform today's organizations and communities by finding solutions to tough, edgy problems in a complex, fast-moving world. They do this by creating new structures, new business models, and new modes of organizing. Throughout the coming year, the MIT Leadership Center, headed by Tracy Purinton, who's here, please stand up so everyone knows who you are, will invite distinctive leaders from around the world who exhibit the best aspects of what it means to be a principled, innovative leader. It is now my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Vivian Ming, our first speaker in this series. Dr. Ming is a theoretical neuroscientist, technologist, and entrepreneur, named one of 10 women to watch in tech by Inc. magazine. Vivian is the co-founder and managing partner of Socos, a cutting-edge edtech company which applies cognitive modeling to align education with life outcomes. Dr. Ming is also a vice president and distinguished scientist at ShiftGig, where she explores how to build job markets that drive long-term economic growth and investing in the workforce. Previously, Dr. Ming was chief scientist at Guild, an innovative startup that builds better companies by unleashing human potential in their workforce using machine learning, something I know many of you care about. Dr. Ming's speaking topics address her philosophy to maximize human potential, emphasizing education and labor markets, diversity, and AI and cybernetics. She has recently presented at South by Southwest, Rework, InfoCamp, Bloomberg, and Columbia University, among many presentations worldwide. Her work and research have received extensive media attention, including the New York Times, NPR, Nature, O Magazine, Forbes, and The Atlantic. She lives in Berkeley with her wife and their two children. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Vivian Ming.
Thank you. All right. I imagine I'm supposed to stand up here on the stage because I'm an important person. That's an excruciating thing to sit through. My ego needs it on a regular basis, but it's still really uncomfortable. So I get to do a lot of different things, which makes my life incredibly fun. And one of the privileges of my life is not having to choose. So I get to do some academic research. I do a lot of nonprofit and philanthropic work. And I have been involved in founding 7 companies. And that affords me the freedom to really choose what I want to do, which means I'm really good at saying no. So when someone comes to me and says, hey, can you help us build our self-driving car project? I say, I don't know what that has to do with maximizing human potential, and I say no. And my lifetime earnings drop significantly. Whereas on the other hand, when someone comes to me and says, is there something we can do in the townships of South Africa that could change the trajectory of these kids' lives? I say, absolutely there is. My work is deeply focused on the intersection of artificial intelligence and labor economics and what most people would call education, but I'm really focused on life outcomes. And so I'm going to take you through a quick tour. I did a review of the slides, and very likely we'll be here for 4 or 5 hours. I think I maybe overdid it a little bit when we put the slide deck together. So forgive me, I may skip through some things and go really quickly through certain projects. But here's what I'm going to say to you, which is you're all clever people. Feel free. Stop me at any time. I'm happy to chat through any of this. I'm not going to go into the technical details of the models because I found that the number of equations on the screen is directly proportional to the sound of snoring in the room. But if you have questions about technical issues, feel free to talk to me afterwards. I'm going to be here for most of the day. All right, so first off, we had that very nice introduction. And I do a lot of things, and it's fancy-smancy, and that's great. But this is what actually matters to me, which is... maximizing human potential. Now, that sounds like a self-help line, but you know, I'm a hard number scientist. So I mean intangible ways. For example, what is my definition of education? We should produce happy, healthy, productive people and let society reap the benefits. Happy, healthy, and productive, to me, are measurable outcomes. When you're looking at a societal level, at the course of a person's lifetime, for the geeks and the wonks in the room, if we're going to integrate in a Bayesian way across all the possible outcomes for a given child, then we should be able to say something right now about what we do with that child that will maximize the likelihood of the best possible outcomes for them. If they can't factorize a polynomial, well, does that have something to do with their life outcomes? I happen to think it frequently will, but maybe not for this kid. And if it doesn't, what do I care? So I started my life as an academic. I still have an appointment at a place called the Redwood Center for Theoretical Neuroscience at UC Berkeley. And my principal interest nowadays is cognitive neuroprosthetics. So can I literally jam things in your brain and make you smarter? And if you're curious, the answer is unambiguously yes. So we don't need to invent new technologies to say it's very clear that there are things that we could do which could have a big impact on people's lives. There happens to be a bit of a shortage of voluntary participants for elective brain surgery. But if anyone here is interested, I know this is a challenged crowd, so. But there was a big jarring experience moving from academia into entrepreneurship. Why I did it is another story. I'm happy to talk about that another time. But certainly, as an academic, you think the world is all about focusing on big problems and solving them in the right way and kind of inflicting your opinion on the world, whereas entrepreneurship is a very different thing. But let me say, what actually matters to me? What matters to me are the things that I build. So, for example, right in the center there on the bottom is scientifically proven to be the cutest kid in the world. A panel of world-renowned scientists, two of them, were queried about this, and we both agreed that our son was the cutest. But we're scientists, so we're always objective. So 5 years ago, Felix was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. I can get really carried away in going into these stories, so I'm going to keep it really tight. I was shocked with his treatment. So I hacked all of his devices, turns out broke several federal laws, and sent all of that data to my personal server where I built a model that predicts about an hour into the future whether his blood glucose levels will go high or low, and was pushing updates to me so that I could intervene before he went high or low. And it actually works. Turns out I'm also breaking federal law if I share that code with anyone. Recently, I gave a talk at Eli Lilly on unrelated things, and they took me aside, and it turns out some kid there is extending my model using deep neural networks. It won't be very long before an artificial pancreas is actually better than a biological one, because they're predictive. And you know, your pancreas is essentially an air conditioner, thermostat. It just goes on and off because your blood sugar goes high or low. Now I'm already going too long on that story, but It is amazing. It won't be too long before the Paralympics are a lot more interesting than the regular Olympics. So an example of me, so I had those updates pushed to my Google Glass, which I had an early release pair for some work I was doing with Google at the time. And then I wore them to the White House. So that is the first and only presidential portrait taken using Google Glass, yes. My first words on meeting the president were, OK, Glass, take a picture. And he thought I was a crazy person. But let me tell you, if any of you ever get into product development, you want people to wear a fluorescent blue computer on their face to a swanky White House party, give them a superpower. I will happily be a fashion tragedy, because I got a push message that my son was going low in 30 minutes. I was in DC. I texted my sister in San Francisco and asked her to give him some crackers. And he didn't go low. I also throw that up there because it's ambiguous whether he's happy or sad. I have to say, when I met the president, largely because I was a security risk inside the White House with a live camera, he looked at me and just shook his head. He was so disgusted. Later, we had a wonderful conversation. But in my opinion, knowing that he wasn't smiling when I first saw him, that's an ambiguous expression on his face. You can see his teeth. He looks a little happy. So what if you couldn't read facial expressions? What if, let's say, it's like a foreign language? If you really work hard, you could learn it. But you don't get it for free. Maybe like me in relationships. So that is a very common symptom of autism. So another thing we did with Google Glass was we built a system that could, with the live camera, process your face, extract what's called the facial action code, turn that into a prediction of what emotion someone's expressing or an inference of that emotion, and then write it on the screen. Scary technologies, right? I could float your credit scores over everyone's head or pull up your Grindr account or something. But in this case, we're building it for autistic kids so that they can learn how to read facial expressions in natural interactions. By the way, the state of the art for comparison are cartoon faces on flashcards. Now, these are things that get you hooked on the idea here initially that you can build things, build products that can genuinely change people's lives. I am a thoroughly mediocre entrepreneur. The only reason I do it is because it is an amazingly effective way to have an impact on the world. So doing these sorts of projects really got me hooked. I actually learned how to do the facial recognition work as an undergrad at UC San Diego doing lie detection for the CIA off of raw video, which is morally gray. I mean, it was an incredibly cool project. And I thought later, let's do something a little more uplifting and valuable with it, like the tool for the autistic kids. But up above, you can see what you might now call a deep neural network, learning how to recognize faces. So that's a video. Those aren't actual people that you're seeing. That's a language of faces. Every one of those individual faces is actually a word in that language. Want to describe a single person? You put a couple of words together, and it makes a sentence. You can describe anyone in the world. What you're not seeing is additional higher levels of that where it actually learns how people perceive faces. And why did we build it? Again, there's a great story that goes along with it that just kills me that I don't get to tell it. We built it to reunite orphan refugees with extended family members. So if you're unaware of this, there are more than 1 million orphan refugees in UN camps around the world, not in the history of the UN, today. So if you can imagine a worse place than a refugee camp, well, how about you take someone's family away from them and then drop them in the refugee camp? So if you're an uncle in Damascus and you haven't heard from your sister's family in months and you're fearing the worst and you go to a camp in Jordan, they give you a book, or at least 10 years ago when we did this project, they give you a book with 1 million photographs in it. So we built this system. It turns out, if the child is in the system, it takes about 3 to 5 minutes. You find them, period. So again, having a huge impact on people's lives. I'm on the board and the chief science advisor of a company called Emoja. We do passive emotional state estimation, just carrying your mobile phone around with you. You don't do anything. Again, potentially a very spooky technology, and I think that's fine. I think the wrong thing is to say you shouldn't do high tech, or you should, but rather say, here are the costs, here are the benefits, here's how we can maximize them, now let's make a rational decision. In this case, my interest, or theirs, as I've talked them into it, bullied is a reasonable term, is doing market research. But to join their board, I had an ask. I have an ask for every board I join. In this case, it was give me all of your data to build a model of bipolar disorder. I'm going to see how early we can predict a manic episode. It turns out right now, one of the employees at the time in confidence came to me and said, actually, I suffer from bipolar. You can start with my data. We're about 3 weeks ahead of the subjective onset of a manic episode. In other words, 3 weeks before this person is ever aware of anything happening, I'm hoping to push it out to 4 weeks, we can say, hey, text them and a trusted confidant, a doctor, a sister, a best friend. Hey, high probability of a manic episode in the next month. Maybe up your medication, take a week off from work, check in with your doctor. 25% of severe sufferers end up killing themselves. Divorce rates, firings, it's just, that's part of the disease as it exists today. So you may notice there's a part of my life here which is solve a problem, and then maybe a year later look around and think, oh shit, who's gonna pay for this? Well, if you're interested in solving problems, that's how you should be doing it. So here's the last one. Mentioned my work in education. I will talk a little bit more about this later, but this is where we're literally trying to predict kids' life outcomes and provide targeted interventions to their parents to change the trajectory of those kids' lives. And we can do it all via SMS, so we can reach kids anywhere in the world that you've got a flip phone and a mobile connection. But as long as I can shut up and better than I am so far, maybe we'll have a chance to talk about it in detail. All right, so building superpowers. So this guy's name is Jade Dominguez. He is, and oh, just a reminder, stop me anytime. Ask questions. I'm making this all up as I go along anyways. So he was an amazing kid, took AP classes in high school, didn't go to college. No one in his family had ever gone to college. He grew up in LA, he didn't go either. I don't know, maybe saying that in Boston makes it sound like no one in LA goes to college. They all aspired to be in the movies. That's pretty true, by the way. But he was a really entrepreneurial guy. So he starts making t-shirts and selling them on the street. Sells them on t-shirts, figure, I bet I can sell more t-shirts if I had a website. So back in the day, gets a sort of a push button kind of website back in the day. It's like, I keep forgetting how old I am. So he starts selling more t-shirts online. Great, awesome, but not good enough. So he teaches himself how to program. Never done it before in his life. For those of you who care, teaches himself Ruby. Anyone been online today? Very likely you were on a site that was in some way running Ruby. So teaches himself Ruby, sells some more t-shirts, but now he doesn't care about the t-shirts anymore. He's frustrated with Ruby. It's what's called an open source language, which means anyone can conceivably contribute. Of course, there is a group of, you know, guards at the gates making certain people aren't just pushing junk code. But his pull requests, as they're called, are getting accepted. His code is going into Ruby, totally self-taught. And then he thinks, why am I selling t-shirts in LA? I should go get one of those highly paid software engineering jobs up in the valley. Well, Silicon Valley, not the valley. And so for a year, he's sending resumes up to San Francisco. And he doesn't even get a single no. Why? It's actually really well understood. For those of you who think of themselves as data scientists, there's no substitute for being domain expertise. Well, this is work at Guild where I was the chief scientist. I had never even been interviewed for a job before when I became the chief scientist of a company that made projects all about recruiting. So I educated my dumb ass. The first 2 months I was a chief scientist, I read everything I could, from business school, from economics, from industrial psychology, about what makes a great employee. Our job, remove bias from the hiring process. Broadly defined. Race, gender, absolutely. Overvaluing certain schools, undervaluing certain skill sets. The whole thing. Who is the best person for this job right now? You might be getting a little clue where I'm going with this. So it's really easy to understand why no one even said no to Jade. First off, they had no idea that he had probably written code that they were running. They gave you 5 seconds. They look at your name, your school, and your last job. Name is Dominguez. Let's be blunt, that is not the right name to get a job in the United States. School, nothing. Last job, nothing. Into the shredder. In this case, the electronic shredder, but same effect. So one day, near the end of this, he gets a call from a startup, guess the name of the company, that says, hey, our algorithm tells us you're the second best Ruby developer in all of Los Angeles. Can we invite you up for an interview? So we flagged Jade up. He ended up being our lead front-end engineer. He was rough around the edges, never worked before, right? There was risk in this hire, but he was great. Actually, when New York Times did a Sunday business section cover article about us, it was about Jade and me. It wasn't about the co-founders, and they got pissed about that. So I have a little bit of a colorful life also. Feel free to talk about it later. And he actually went and eventually founded his own company. And we got 2 years of amazing productivity out of someone no one else would touch. Not because we're good people, and not because we were doing him a favor. It's because we, and frankly, and everyone else, were just too stupid to see where value, or let's put it more accurately, but just as bluntly, too lazy to figure out where real talent lay. By the way, this OPM, I won't go into detail there, but it was just a hackathon project I did for the Office of Personnel Management. If you're not familiar, it's basically the HR of the federal government. 6 million employees, 20 million resumes go through their system every year. One thing I'm sure none of you are familiar with, but one thing about being a recruiter is you get one piece of feedback. Well, two, really. The first is, God damn it, you haven't filled that job rec. And the second, the only post-hire feedback you get is that person was terrible. And you only hear it within the first few weeks of a hire. If someone's really great, you know, over a course of 5 years, or really terrible, you never know. So I hacked this system together that looked at the OPM data. So when you logged in as a particular recruiter, we saw all of your past hiring history. We then color-coded the resume to reflect your bias. This school's in red. For some reason, you seem to think someone needs to go to MIT to do this job, but we just don't see it borne out in the data. This gender's in blue. You undervalue it. Guess which one? These skills are in red. These skills are in blue. So right there when you log in, you see your own bias reflected back at you. By the way, no one is ever going to run a system like this. Right? Isn't that basically admitting to systematic bias? There's nothing wrong with being systematically biased as long as you're not aware of it. Because if you're aware of it, then you're knowingly breaking the law. If you're unaware of it, you have full defense. But nonetheless, what a thing to actually know what impact your decision right now, 2 potential hires in front of you, to know the impact of your decision in picking one over the other. Because I'll have to say, as I'll talk a little bit more about issues of inclusion and diversity, but it's one thing to believe that there's value. I was an advisor to Credit Suisse when we released this report saying, having 4 different measures of shareholder value, having at least 1 woman on the board increased return to shareholder by 3%, having at least 3 or more women increased it by 5%. And you could break that down in different global regions, and it held just as true. Great. Now I've got 2 resumes in front of me. I want to hire the straight white guy. Is that my bias, or is that me doing my job? I think there's a huge disconnect between aspiration and action. It plays out in everything we do, but it is particularly pernicious in this specific domain. Okay, so here's a similar story. This guy is named Jose Zamora, and he wrote a blog post that went viral. Huffington Post, USA News and World Report picked it up. He claims he's sending out 100 resumes a week and getting no responses. So he drops the S out of his name. And so he claims in the blog post, Joe's getting job offers that Jose isn't. And so USA News calls me up, at the time seemingly the only person doing big data in labor economics. Not true anymore, but, and they say, is this plausible? So I got angry with that question. And I couldn't at the time, but I've subsequently done it. I can dig up dozens of stories in USA News and World Report on things I'm sure everyone here has heard before. If you take an identical resume and you put a male or female name at the top, if you take an identical resume and you put an African-American versus Caucasian-sounding name at the top, here's one of my favorites, particularly coming from Silicon Valley, the world's greatest meritocracy. We should have that up on the hills, like the Hollywood sign. Take a work history, identical work history, put a male or female name at the top, give it to actual hiring managers. Have them decide whether this person should get a promotion, and if so, what kind of a raise they should get. So, identical work history, males substantially more likely to get the promotion, and when they do, they get a bigger raise. Okay, that's not different than anything else I just said. So, here's my favorite thing. The solution, meritocracy. I just gave a talk at Athena Health on Tuesday, and that's like part of their ethos there. How do we deal with the fact that we have no women in leadership positions here at the company? Meritocracy. So in this experimental manipulation, you either had a sham cover story or an explicit or implicit cover story explicitly about meritocracy. And it makes the bias worse. Something done with the purpose of removing bias actually makes it worse. So again, for the geeks in the room, I got a hold of the data. I did a Bayesian model of it. Bayesian models have a couple of different components, noise, your prior belief about the world, think of it like the bias component, and the data likelihood. Think of that as your judgment about the resume or the work history. So we're trying to tell people, focus on the likelihood, focus on the resume. But actually what you do is you raise the noise. Nobody's intentionally hiring the wrong person. They're not like systematically saying, I mean, I'm not saying no such person exists, but for the most part, no one says, wow, this person would be great, but I hate chicks. So, no. Even when they are intentionally hiring men, it is because they think men are better at the job. They're wrong, but that's what they think. So when you tell them, oh, by the way, everything you're currently doing in your job, stop doing that. Meritocracy, just for once today, then all they do is they say, wow, the world is not what I thought. It's a lot noisier, and they fall back on their bias even harder. So things we do that we think make it better frequently actually make it worse. And there are numerous examples of this. Okay, way off track. Back to Jose. So they call me up, and I give them this long lecture, and they're angry with me. But I get it. People don't like research. Now, how many times someone has said to me, you know, you can show anything with research. And I say, you know, Mom, that's my job. I wish I was joking. Before I went through gender transition, she was like a Fox News quoting machine. If nothing else, I've had that one positive impact on the world. So I thought, let's take a totally different approach. Let's say, at Guild, we built this database of 122 million people. Every public piece of data we could scrape off of your professional digital footprint. LinkedIn, Facebook, GitHub, Bitbucket, Stack Exchange, Twitter, blog posts, everything we could find about you. And we built this model that said, actually, it started with hundreds of thousands of data points. We narrowed it down to 55,000 data points to say, are you the right person for this particular job? Was the model right every time? No, nothing is. We can talk about that if we want to. Would I rather make a decision about whether my kids should go in for a job interview versus the recruiter looking at three things? Yeah, I would take my model. So I thought, what if I pulled out every single Joe and every single Jose in my data set? 150,000 Joes, no Josephs, Joe, as identified on LinkedIn. And Jose, US and Canada based. Totally different story if we're talking about South America. And in that context, I say, what does Jose need to get the same probability of a promotion for the same quality of work? Right? Because we have models that are equating the quality of work. Not that that's a trivial thing at all, but we do have lots of data. So I'm going to take an idea from economics, signaling. So the classic example of signaling is the male peacock's tail, this big, gigantic, beautiful tail, which is a complete waste of energy. You're dragging this thing around with you. It is such a white elephant. But you're signaling to the world, I am so fit. You know, I can afford to waste all this energy. So hey, females, you know, come mate with me. I've got this awesome Porsche. A tail, so sorry, tail. All right, so that's the idea. But we're going to turn that around here. What does Jose need to signal to get that job, that promotion? What we found, for example, is Jose needed a master's degree or higher to be competitive against Joe with no degree whatsoever. This is specifically looking at software engineers in the Valley. Wow. Now I can start to put some real numbers to this. That's 6 years of tuition, 6 years of opportunity cost as a software engineer. I'm not even going to look at the loss of lifetime earnings. I mean, let's be really clear. Discrimination comes with compound interest. So you really want to understand the long-term impact. You've got to understand the long-term impact starting at age zero and then integrating across someone's entire family history. But I'm just talking about that immediate measurable difference. In fact, we found innumerable differences, and I came up with this idea, but I'll come back to it in just a moment. So we find Jose needs to attend more prestigious schools for longer periods, earn higher degrees, more degrees, work at more prestigious companies for longer periods of time, and also this interesting additional fact, which is additional awards and exceptional qualities that really make you stand out in a way that you wouldn't have to if you were Joe. So what does it come to? I thought, well, I want to put this in a language that hopefully anyone can understand. So it's a tax. It's the tax on being different. And for Jose, that tax comes out to roughly $750,000. Needless to say, there's a range there, but that's a reasonable median estimate. For women in the tech industry, that's roughly $250,000. The Economist asked me to compute what it is to be gay in the UK. $70,000 may not sound like a lot of money, but imagine we just arbitrarily took one out of every 10 young men born in the UK. We went to their families at age 5 and said, you owe us $5,000 a year for the next 15 years, and you can't opt out. This can have a profound impact on the life outcomes of those kids. In some cases where you get into intersectionality, these numbers get really big. It is not a universally superlinear phenomenon, but it tends to be. So this actually says women in Singapore, it's actually lesbians in Singapore and Hong Kong, typically need PhDs to be competitive for jobs that don't require degrees. So these are huge additional costs. So I wrote an op-ed for the Financial Times recently where I talked about this, but I also said, what if we then strip away all of these traditional markers, race and gender, and in their place we just put these numbers, these taxes, right? And to be clear, in case it's not, these taxes don't pave roads, they don't build bridges, right? It's just heat loss in the economy. Working extra hard to grow is great. Working extra hard just to prove who you are? No, that's crap. So we put this into the model. And you have to go to macroeconomic, microeconomic modeling, and you have to go into some detail and model out the development of people's temporal discounting of reward and so forth. But what we found was it explains, at least in part, a lot of known phenomenon. Why do women drop out of the executive ranks? Why do high-performing kids from underrepresented populations, straight-A students in high school, full scholarship to come here, they don't do it? I mean, known phenomenon for 100 years. Well, this plays out actually, in the article, I put it in a very personal context, one that abstracted away the issue of race and sex. My father grew up on a farm in a part of Kansas that is to Kansas what Kansas is to the rest of the world. Really, Kansans are always like, no, tell me the name. Hartner, never heard of that. Okay, next biggest town is Medicine Lodge. Nope. Well, Alva, Oklahoma would be, and then they say, just stop, we're not getting anywhere. It's a town where we have to push the tumbleweeds out of the way now to see the foundations. When he graduated from high school in 1957, he graduated top high school student in the state of Kansas. Now, for all I know, that could have been 12 kids, but still, it's something. And he got a full scholarship here. And he didn't go. Why did he go to University of Kansas instead and tutor Wilt Chamberlain in chemistry? Because in the words of my grandparents, what's the point of going to some technical school halfway across the country if you're just going to end up back on the farm? Why work three times as hard when you know the outcomes won't be the same anyways? Interestingly enough, the Vietnam War very much changed his life. I then grew up relatively well off and privileged in California. To me, his decision seems wildly irrational and crazy. Whether you're growing up on the farm or in the barrio, like, this is your ticket out. And this is a big problem, is we see everyone else's decisions through our model. And yes, I mean that literally, our model, in the kind of work I do. And so we see them, and we see that they're not taking that scholarship. They are not sticking it out to join the C-suite. But think about it, not to pick on Athena Health, but just since I was there, they have no women in their senior leadership and no one of color. So when I hear companies say, well, this is a pipeline problem, right? If we could just convince them that it was worth getting that STEM degree and work hard and be gritty like it's all just a choice, then they'd come all the way through. Yet, the most explicit thing you're telling them is not the media campaign you're trying to sport around STEM education for girls in high school. The most clearest signal you're telling them is, we don't hire people like you. So why bother? And why bother becomes a pretty strong disincentive for doing anything. All right. I will talk about this just very briefly. I'm the vice chair of a nonprofit called Start Out. It is a national, soon to be international, LGBT entrepreneurship group. We have chapters around the US, including here in Boston. We're about to start chapters in London and hopefully Berlin and Tel Aviv. So at the beginning of this presidential election, I heard a lot of candidates talking about growth economies. And essentially that was shorthand, to be very specific, shorthand for Texas. It was shorthand for low taxes, low regulation. Believe me, I've started 7 companies. I've never made a decision based on taxes, but I hate the regulation. Hate it with a passion. It is incredibly frustrating to have to go through hoops to try and add value to your community. But again, I found the companies anyways. I want to solve the problems. I'll do what I need to do to make it happen. So I've had a different feeling about what actually drives growth economies. So this was an opportunity to look at that, because there's one minority group whom it is legal to discriminate against in a business concept, at least on a state-by-state basis, which gives us this really interesting natural experiment. And that's gay and lesbian anybody, which is the famous saying nowadays is you get married on Sunday and then fired on Monday. And that's true in 23 states. So that provides an interesting story, because the overwhelming story of labor migration is, for example, from California to Texas. The cost of labor is so high in California that if Google wants a new data center, they build it in Wyoming. If they need a new call center, they build it in Texas or New Mexico. So all of the jobs, if you look at Bureau of Labor Statistics, all the jobs flow out into these other states. I thought, what if we looked at the entrepreneurs? And we actually counted how many jobs they created when they moved to San Francisco or Boston or Seattle, and treated that as labor migration. So how do we do this? Well, first we start with census data. Thank you, census. And then using some sneaky big data techniques that involves things that I happen, first time I ever met Reid Hoffman, he says, oh, I know who you are. I don't like you. I've borrowed lots of LinkedIn data. So we tracked 100,599 entrepreneurs over a 10-year period, 2005 to 2014. We looked at where they were born, where they founded their companies, where they incorporated their companies, how many jobs they created, how much money they brought in. OK, interesting. And that's the green one. And you see the regular suspects. So entrepreneurs are about 3.1 times as likely to move to California as the average American. Unsurprising. Seattle, Massachusetts, New York, Texas, Florida, all see similar, if slightly less, numbers. What about gay and lesbian entrepreneurs that might be acting under slightly different incentives? What we see is they are 11 to 13 times as likely as the average American to move to California. They are overwhelmingly likely to move to states, to cities that have high HRC numbers, well represented in terms of municipality inclusion index. All right, that's not so surprising. There could be a number of things. I mean, the entrepreneurs could just be chasing the money. And, you know, I guess maybe then the gay entrepreneurs could be chasing tail and money or something like this. But you see some interesting things, particularly with states like Texas, which is strongly positive for entrepreneurial migration and negative for gay and lesbian. They leave Texas. And then you can break Texas down. Austin is positive on both, and all the other cities are positive on one and negative on the other. So interestingly, we're acting under the same state laws. We're acting under the same economic incentives. But believe me, if you've ever had this discussion with someone who lives in Austin, it's not like the rest of Texas. That is the refrain that I hear from everyone, as though, does that mean they get to act under different judicial decisions than the Texas Supreme Court? Because I like being a woman. But what I get at here, and here's the punchline of this whole thing. Over that 10-year period, 2.8 million Americans held jobs created by LGBT entrepreneurs. Net jobs. 1.1 million of those jobs would have been created in Raleigh-Durham, or Indianapolis, or Phoenix. But instead, they moved to Boston, and Seattle, and San Francisco. Almost certainly because of discrimination. Why would you possibly tell your own sons and daughters to go solve someone else's problems because you're more concerned about which bathrooms they were using or who they love? And what's interesting is from that data, I can then extrapolate, well, what about female entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs of color? When you look at that in total for a state like California, you see an overwhelming net positive migration of jobs in the heads of those entrepreneurs. Vastly more. And of course, not only the total job flow is positive into California, those are headquarter jobs. Those are engineers and salespeople, not call center workers. That is a trade I will make over and over again, except that I'm trying to buy a house. So I'd appreciate it if some of these communities would keep their jobs at home. All right, so I've gone long on a lot of this, and so I should make things a little faster, but I got to ask, does anyone know who this is? Somebody? There are no skater dudes here at all? So this is Rodney Mullen. He's arguably the greatest skateboarder of all time. He won 59 world championships in a row from the late 70s to the early 90s. OK, we got one person I think who knows. So I had the pleasure of having lunch with Rodney several years ago. And he's a lot more interesting person than I would have imagined a professional skateboarder to be. But what I wanted to know, I care nothing about skateboarding. I said, Rodney, what do you do after you win a world champion? Say it's the 40th time. He says, he's always on a skateboard. Well, Tony Hawk and I, we go to the after party and we drink some champagne. And I don't know, 20, 30 minutes later, we're at back practicing new moves. So my very short time with Rodney told me he likes to party. He's not trying to get out of this like socially awkward situation. And it's his 40th world championship in a row. He's not afraid of getting beaten. He's not doing this because of the external incentives. He's doing this because that's who he is. So this is a talk I gave for TED, which I called The Fanatic. They decided to call it The Paradox of Incentive Insensitivity. Rolls right off the tongue. But that is, in fact, the spirit of it, which is when you look at where the incentives are the highest, you see the worst performance over the long run. When you really want to understand who is your best person, who's your best salesperson, who's your best software developer, look at what they do when they don't have to do anything. That is the moment where you can see it. And that may sound like a line, but actually, if you really think about it, there are some strategic and very measurable moments where that happens. For example, who makes a sale the day after the end of the sales cycle? Every company I've ever had has been on a sales cycle. We have people like calling Hawaii at 11 p.m. California time because they heard a head of HR was on her honeymoon just so they could book that sale in time to show the board. Because the next day, some of you are getting fired and some of you are getting bonus payments. Highly, as I call it, exogenously incentivized. Well, when we, and this gets a little geeky, but when we do a Fourier analysis of the time series behavior of the sales of these people, we see something exactly the opposite. Your best people are the people with the widest spectrum. They're the people making sales the next day. In fact, sales the next day isn't just no incentives. It's probably going to piss your VP of sales off. So same thing with software engineers pushing code after products already ready, and we see it again and again. And just to be clear, I'm talking about that giant data set I had before. So these are hundreds of thousands of salespeople we were looking at. Hundreds of thousands, in fact, 11 million software engineers, but about a million that we could at actual GitHub information on their pushes. So this is a profound story about what actually predicts life outcomes. I've extended this in my work with education, which I've run out of time to actually go into the details of. But we find what really predicts life outcomes is general cognitive ability, metacognition, problem solving, personality and mindset, things like grit and motivation, creativity, and social relationships, the ability to perceive and understand the emotions of others and yourself. This is it. Notice that I didn't mention going to MIT, or the grades you got, or the amazing test scores that you have. I didn't mention the companies you've worked for. All of those in isolation are highly predictive. But once I know these other things about you, they tell me almost nothing. A Bachelor of Computer Science from Stanford is at best a very modest, though positive, predictor of your ability as a software developer. It's a great signal of all these other qualities about you, but doesn't seem to be in and of itself a big additive value. So when you're looking at employees and how you structure the incentive system of your company, keep that in mind. It's really easy to build a clearly and transparently incentivized workforce that in the long run is sapping all of the productivity. And believe me, I have just described the American education system. So this is it. If it doesn't matter whether you know how to program, I have some friends that just developed a deep neural network that will write programs for you. If it doesn't matter whether you know how to factorize a polynomial, I mean, let's be frank, who actually does this anymore in their head when you've got, you know, Mathematica to do it for you? This is the only job description that you will see in the world going forward. It's going to take time to get there, but people like me, if you're doing the same job next week that you were doing this week, someone like me is going to come along and say, I bet I could build an AI that can do this faster, cheaper, better. And so I call this the hyperinflation of work. you're always going to be doing something new and different. And the real fear point here for me is it takes 20 years to build a person, if you can stand that metaphor, and we are not building people for that future. We have an audience here, I'm sure, that is well situated, but there's another 5 to 6 billion people that I'm genuinely concerned with. I mean, catastrophic level concerned with. So there's so much more. This is the education work. I'm not going to have the time to do it, except that it is incredibly awesome. It is the most revolutionary thing anyone has ever done of all time. And if any of you are filthy, stinking rich, feel free to give it to me. I will say that in modeling out our education work or anything like it, we find it adds 10% to the US GDP. 60%, this is a non-linear scale here, sorry, it looks so weird. 60% to the South African GDP and 110% to South African GDP, to the Indian GDP. In other words, focusing on these qualities that are actually predictive of life outcomes rather than tools, focus on the craftsmen, not the tools. This is the long-term economic result modeled on empirical research, tracking people across their lifetime, not a theoretical model. This is Muse. Endure that just for a second. So this is my close here. I haven't explained this lead-in at all, except to say I flunked out of college. I lived in my car for a couple of years. And at one point, I was deciding whether to kill myself or not. I had a really unhappy first 30 years of my life. And feel free to ask me about that. At that moment, I took a line from my father, which was, live a life of substance. I was never going to be happy. I believed that fundamentally. So I'm going to define a life of substance as the purpose isn't for me to be happy. It's to make a difference in other people's lives. And I made that my measurable outcome of interest. And for 10 years, I got a job at a convenience store. And then I managed a convenience store. Then I ran an abalone farm in Santa Cruz. Ask me afterwards how that relates to gun running. I went back to school, same one I flunked out of, UC San Diego, just gave the convocation there, 8,000 freshmen, and finished my undergraduate degree in a single year and got perfect scores in every class. Same person, same school, same topics. Wasn't what I was doing, it was why I was doing it, to paraphrase Simon Sinek. So, live a life of substance. Build superpowers. If you're interested in being an entrepreneur, really. I know a lot of people say, why is everyone solving these selling ad problems? Well, it's because what you pay them to do. So, screw what the VCs are willing to invest in. Go do it anyways. Embrace cyborgs. I didn't talk about this at all, but really, 15 to 25 years from now, cognitive neuroprosthetics will fundamentally change the definition of what it means to be human. Coolest invitation to give a talk I've given is to come to the Vatican and talk about it. It's like, wow, the transgendered neuroscientist gets to talk about cyborgs at the Pope? Foster fanaticism, not just in yourself, but in your coworkers and in your employees. Never knock someone down for doing something geeky, because that's where it comes from. That's the heart of success. And then reincarnate. And the best story here of reincarnation, I have obviously my life story that I shared with you, but I love this one. Who here has ever heard of Saturday Morning Breakfast Cereal? The best comic strip in the world. Basically, for those of you who don't know, it's dirty jokes for physicists. A recent strip was how to ask for rough sex classified by scientific discipline. Go check that out. But this one really resonated with me. This is true. One day you'll be dead. This is false. You only live once. It takes 7 years to master something. It's actually more complex than that, but the spirit's true. Therefore, starting at age 11, if you live to be 88, you have 11 opportunities to become truly great at something. These are your lifetimes. And it goes on to explain people that don't get it. Oh, I always knew I was meant to do spreadsheets my whole life. And I've been there for many of these, but I won't belabor them. I love this transition one. 2 years till I die. I wonder what I'm going to do next. This is me right now. I'm kind of done with doing startups. I'm writing 6 books, never having written one before. I figured, hey, let's go stupid. I've been asked to run for office, all these sorts of things. I'm trying to figure out what actually is next. And that's great. In fact, I would say, pick yourself at your peak and die. Take it to the next life. Poetry and hover bikes and physics and philosophy. These are your lifetimes. And I beg everyone in this audience to use them. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Vivian. They're running off to class. But
yes,
thank you, everyone,
thank you
for joining us.
Me.
We have a small gift for you.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Absolutely.
See you at the next iLead, which is?
November 1st.
November 1st.
Absolutely.